screen. Hopefully everybody could see that. And here we go. So my presentation this morning is about one of the very recent invasive crayfish in Ontario. The other culprit, my co-author Brooke Schreier is gonna talk about later this morning. So invasive crayfish are a big problem worldwide. This is a gallery of the seven, worst rogues that are invading every continent except Antarctica, I guess. Africa, which never had any crayfish, now has at least a couple. And it's the case everywhere. I could talk about these seven, but that would be another presentation. So just a bit of background. In Ontario, we have the richest fauna of crayfish. We have 8 native crayfish and 4 introduced, compared to Canada, where we have 15 species and 5 introduced. Now, in Ontario, we have more than just the 2 that I mentioned. We have 3 other species of introduced crayfish: the rusty crayfish, which some of you may be already familiar with. It's widespread and it's replaced natives at high density all over Ontario. Here in the Kawartas, where I am today, it's really difficult to find a native crayfish. Most of the crayfish you see are rusties. Then there's the Allegheny crayfish, which occurs in Ontario and Quebec. It's not as widely spread. It's in a few locations, mostly in northern Ontario. The ID is difficult because people confuse it with some of the natives and with the hybrids of rusty crayfish with natives. So it's always been misidentified, but it looks like it's not expanding in Ontario. And then the third one is the famous asexual marbot crayfish, which was in the news lately, but Brooke's going to talk about those later today, so I'll leave that. Just to recap the regulations in Ontario: crayfish can be used as bait in Ontario, but they have to be used in the same water body as they were caught. So if you're fishing in a lake, you can catch crayfish and use them as bait. They cannot, however, be transported overland dead or alive. The other important thing here is that the genus Procambarus, which this White River crayfish that I'm talking about is a part of, has been prohibited as of the beginning of this year, and together with another genus from out west, as well as a yabby from Australia. There is no really federal regulations for crayfish. Crayfish are mostly regulated provincially. The only one that's regulated federally is the rusty crayfish, and only in Manitoba. So this is what the beast that I'm talking about today. It's a large crayfish. It's very similar to the Louisiana red crawfish, which some of you may have eaten or have seen at restaurants or other places because it's famous. It's very similar, but it's also large. But the difference is that it has this open areola, which is this part on the carapace. It has a very characteristic 4-pronged male gonopod, which is the male reproductive appendage, and it also has these elongated, very tuberculated claws. As I said, it can get very large. This specimen is actually from Ontario. It's from from Pelee Island, and it's one of the largest specimens ever caught. It was more than 25 centimeters long. This is the distribution of this crayfish. In brown, you see the native range of it, and then the circles are all introduced populations in the States. So you could see it's been introduced quite widely, and the two red spots are the Canadian two places where you found them in Ontario so far and Canada. So the first place that they were found is actually on Pelee Island, and it looks like they were there already since 2015, but they were not recognized and therefore not established. But we know now that they're there, they've been there for a while, and they're breeding. We're a bit worried about them because they may be in competition with two local burrowing species that are endemic to the island, and also some endangered salamanders, because the salamanders can use crayfish burrows, and these things all make big burrows. And we're worried about predation on the salamanders and competition. And the other place that turned up in 2022, we started getting reports from the Severn Sound region, and they first turned up on iNaturalist. I identified them as being white river crayfish. They were all caught walking on land, except for this one that's in the middle here. That was photographed at the Port Severn Marina by one of the workers there, and she thought it was a lobster, actually. Anyway, so we went out late in the year in 2022 and looked for these crayfish. We couldn't find them at Six Mile Lake Provincial Park or in Port Severn. But we did see one at the Port Severn Marina where that picture was taken. So, but no captures, but we did see one. But it was late in the season, so we returned with the OFAH invasive species crew, and we did a proper survey during the following summer, and we found lots of crayfish in several size classes. None of the females that we caught that were mature had eggs attached, but some of them had glare glands, and these glands signify that they will mate soon. They use this glare to extrude and attach the eggs to the abdomen. We dug a lot of burrows. There was a lot of burrows under the bank. They were a little bit cryptic, but you could see the openings and in some cases the excavation. And in this picture here, you could see the excavation. And so we were digging these burrows, and you could see Jeff sticking his hand down one of the burrows. They were deep, but luckily the crayfish seemed to be active, and they were inside the burrows, and we were able to pull them out. So we caught these crayfish, and we also had these signs made up before we went out there and installed these signs at the Six Mile Lake Provincial Park, Port Severn Park, as well as the marina. And Dr. Hosey from Trent University took some signs to Pelee Island, and they were also put there. We suspect that the vector of introduction of this species has been bait use for angling, because both Pelee Island and Port Severn and Six Mile Lake are popular angling places where that host angling tournament with lots of American visitors. So we went out again in September 2023. Brooke and I went actually on a bit of a vacation, crayfish vacation, and did some sampling at night and during the day, and we got lots more crayfish. We found lots of crayfish in all the places where we found them before, and two other places, McLean Lake and Black River, where we hadn't found them. So it looks like they're spread a lot more and established. I also managed to catch one female with eggs, which is a big deal, because it shows us that they're breeding. And these females are very cryptic. If you look at there's very little actually life history information in the literature on this crayfish, because the females carrying eggs are very cryptic. They're hard to find. And so there's very little information on reproduction, but they can carry up to 500 to 600 eggs on a big female. Another worrying thing that besides all these new records is that a new iNaturalist record turned up in summer 2023 in the Sturgeon Bay area, which is a little bit further south, and it's directly connected to Georgian Bay and Lake Huron. Therefore, there's a chance that these things are actually already in Georgian Bay. So, why do we need to worry about them? Well, there's competition with native crayfishes for food and shelter. They can impact biodiversity and alter the whole food web. They can predate on insects and mollusks like clams and snails, as well as fish eggs and fish fry. They also like to eat plants, so they can consume a lot of aquatic macrophytes. And because they do these huge burrows, they can destabilize shorelines. In Port Severn, they also use the rocks that are piled up at the piers and stuff. But if there's no rocks, they will burrow quite extensively. And here is a picture here with the red arrow. I don't know if you could see it. It's actually one of the captive specimens that we brought back feeding on a juvenile northern clearwater crayfish, which is a native. We had them in a tank together, and this crayfish was catching the little ones and eating them kind of like popcorn. The other big worry is that when we did all those surveys in the Port Severn area, we did not find any natives sympatric with these things. So it was only White River crayfish in the area where they were, no natives whatsoever, which doesn't bode well. So what can we do? What is our management strategies? We can educate people. I think we need to educate anglers, naturalists, and the general public in an effective way of preventing this introduction and spread of these crayfishes. So don't move them, you know. More signage, we need more signs, post them in areas where we think these things are. And obviously people need to be able to identify them. So they are in some ways easy to identify because they're much bigger and they're red and they don't really look like our native crayfish, but we are in preparation with Brooke. Also, we're making a new crayfish guide for 2024. We're hoping that it'll be out in May and we can distribute it to the public and researchers, and they'll be able to ID crayfish using this guide. Citizen science obviously is really important because this is how we figured out that these things were in Ontario from iNaturalist, EdMaps, and so on. And if you see these, you need to report them to the invasive species hotline. We want to continue the surveys around the Port Severn area and Pelee Island to determine the distribution and the effect on the ecosystem and on the native populations. And lastly, the regulations for this genus need to be enforced. I mean, they're in place as of January 2024. They're prohibited, which means you can't move them. You can't be in possession of them. And therefore, the anglers should strongly be discouraged from using them as bait if they happen to catch them. So I just want to thank OFAH and Brooke, my co-author and co-worker in the field. And these are our contacts. And if you have any more questions or comments or reports of White River crayfish, please do not hesitate to get in contact with us. Thank you.
Thank you, Premek. So we have a few minutes for questions. So if you do have a question, please just put it in the Q&A box. So the first one we have is, would a hybrid between a rusty crayfish and a native species still be considered invasive?
Yes, I would say so. The problem with the Restes is, and there are different, I mean, I could talk about them and I should talk about them, but when the hybrids backcross, they usually produce Restes. They don't produce natives. And the American researchers have shown this actually.
Okay. Another question we have is, what's the perception of the general public when you try to involve them in citizen science?
People are very positive. People have been very helpful in looking for these things. On iNaturalist, there's a couple of people who are really active and actively looking for these. And as I said, we've had new reports. So people are very, very good, but they're also ignorant of the laws, and they also can't tell crayfish apart. When I tell people in the Kawartas that they're looking at Restes, that all the crayfish they see are Restes, they just can't believe that they're from Ohio, that they're not from from Canada. So, you know, we need to educate people.
Hey, I think that's all we have for questions right now. So we'll just wait a couple more minutes to see if any more come in.
If you don't mind, Jen, I'll just touch on that last question as well.
Go ahead.
A really nice thing too is in the development of those signs, we didn't install that many per se. I think we installed 3 or 4 around the Port Severn area. And then I think 5 of them went to Pelee Island. But even with that small amount of signage, we've been getting a number of people calling the hotline, a number of people reporting White River crayfish online, which is helping us determine the distribution of this species currently in those areas. So it's really great to see that the signage is working, that individuals are recognizing the crayfishes based on the drawing that Premick did and the photos that we have on the sign, and getting those reports into us.
And as I said, I think when the guide comes out, it'll be super helpful. There hasn't really been anything. There's a very old book that's now out of print called The Crayfishes of Ontario, which doesn't have a lot of the species that are here now. Certainly not all the invasives. And Brooke will talk about the marbled crayfish, which is another big problem coming. And so I think the guide will be really helpful, and we'll make sure we can get it out to people to use.
Yeah, and it will be available on invadingspecies.com. So you will be able to download it. We will also have a number of physical copies, which we'll be hopefully handing out at various trade shows and whatnot moving forward. And that should actually be towards the end of March when that's available. So hopefully look for that on invadingspecies.com. It'll be, like I said, it'll be downloadable.
And it's really, I just want to emphasize that it's really important for people who may be listening who are from the two regions that are of concern, that if they do see weird crayfish, they take lots of good photos in sharp focus, and either post them on iNaturalist or send them to me or Brooke, because it's super helpful for us. We can't be everywhere. It's very difficult to get out there and do surveys.
Yeah. And then for our people listening from the US, Doug Jensen did mention that they're also working on a crayfish guide in the US. So be sure to look out for that. And then just to Doug also identify that there's some questions in the Q&A. Are those signs, can the public order? So those signs were a very limited run. But that being said, we're always happy to work with individuals to get them whatever signage they need, whether it's clean, drain, dry, or invasive carps, or in this case, crayfishes, or don't let it loose. So Julia, if you would like to get in touch, I'll be presenting at 10 o'clock and my email will be on the last slide. So if you just want to grab my email and shoot me a message, I'll be sure to work with getting you some signage.
Yeah, a big message is let's just not move any crayfish anywhere. And especially do not release them anywhere. Like if you do happen to catch one of these things, which I didn't say, the best way to dispose of them is to put them in your freezer overnight, and they'll just basically go to sleep and then freeze. So it's a humane way of euthanizing them. And then you could just either bury them or throw them in the rubbish.
Okay, thank you very much, Premek. So that is all the time we have for questions. So up next, we have a presentation from Aaron Franchville from St. Mary's University. I'll just share this.
Okay, great. Hopefully that's visible for everybody. So I'm Erin Franchville. I'm a Master's of Science candidate at St. Mary's University in Halifax, Nova Scotia. My advisor is Dr. Linda Campbell in the Environmental Science Department. We do have some collaborators on this project with Department of Fisheries and Oceans, Nova Scotia, the Department of Fisheries and Aquaculture, Nova Scotia, and Cape Breton University. And so the working title of this project is The Impacts of Introduced Chain Pickerel, which is an invasive fish species, on lake food web structure and the implications for species at risk. And so this is a comparative study comparing a lake with and without chain pickerel using stable isotope analysis, which I'll explain further. So what are chain pickerel, our invasive fish species? Well, they're introduced to New Brunswick and Nova Scotia. Their native distribution or natural range primarily consists of the Atlantic slope from Southwest Maine to Southern Florida. They're site-oriented ambush predators. So they're often found in slow-moving waters in the littoral zone or near shore zone, camouflaged among vegetation, where they can easily ambush their prey. And their diet is largely piscivorous in nature, meaning that they eat other fish species. And so what's interesting about this photo here is there's kind of a distinct dietary shift in chain pickerel that occurs at a benchmark of approximately 15 centimeters in length. So chain pickerel 15 centimeters and below, as seen on the bottom picture, their diet primarily consists of benthic macroinvertebrates, largely dragonfly nymphs. Whereas chain pickerel 15 centimeters and above, like the one seen in the top photo, which is approximately 30 centimeters, their diet consists primarily of other fish. So approximately 60% of their diet or more consists of other fish species. And so I won't spend long here, but chain pickerel were first introduced into Nova Scotia in 1945 into just three lakes for sport fishing purposes. But have since then followed kind of a classic invasive species curve, where over time there's kind of exponential growth and spread into new habitat and new freshwater bodies of water. And so we're just seeing this exponential growth and spread curve of a classic invasive species introduction mirrored in the chain pickerel in Atlantic Canada. And so as of this year, they're found in over 300 distinct bodies of water in New Brunswick and Nova Scotia. So what are the known impacts? They're not very well studied in Atlantic Canada. However, there was a really important report commissioned by the Nova Scotia Department of Fisheries and Aquaculture in 2010. And so what they did is they compared lakes with and without chain pickerel, specifically looking at fish community structure. And what they found was there was three very consistent impacts of chain pickerel in these lakes. So first they found that fish community structure was simplified in lakes with chain pickerel. So there were less different species of fish caught in lakes that contain chain pickerel. Second, there was a reduction in overall fish abundance in lakes. So less fish were caught overall in lakes that contain chain pickerel versus lakes without. And lastly, there was a truncation in fish size distribution. And so there was an absence of small-bodied fish and small prey fish species in lakes that contain chain pickerel. So knowing this, what are the gaps in this knowledge? How do chain pickerel impact entire lake food webs? And how are our vulnerable species at risk impacted? So that's the goal of that study. It's to evaluate those two things, overall food web impacts and impacts to a vulnerable at-risk species. So our at-risk species is yellow layup mussel. It's a freshwater mussel native to Eastern North America. It was assessed as special concern by COSWIC and on Schedule 1 of the Species at Risk Act and listed as threatened under the Nova Scotia Endangered Species Act. And so what's really interesting about yellow lamp mussel is during this portion of their life cycle where they are what we call obligate parasitoids. So they have a larval phase where they require a fish host to continue their life cycle. And so adult mussels release this larval phase of mussel called glaucidia. They attach to the gills of a selected fish host where they feed on the nutrients from their fish host for around 40 to 80 days before dropping as juvenile mussels to the substrate where they continue this life cycle. So what's really interesting about yellow lamp mussel in Nova Scotia is currently white perch is the only fish species that appears to host yellow lamp mussel glaucidia. And they're the only fish species in Nova Scotia where they found yellow lamp mussel glaucidia on their gills. So they're crucial to the survival and recruitment of yellow lamp mussel. So what we're gonna focus on later in this project is really the relationship between chain pickerel and white perch, as we do know already that chain pickerel can vastly impact fish community structure and the potential implications that this might have for the yellow lamp mussel, which requires white perch as its fish host. And the last thing I'd like to say about yellow lamp mussel is, like other freshwater mussel species, they're really important and have a lot of ecological significance to food webs and overall ecosystems. So they're filter feeders. So they filter nutrients, organic debris, and phytoplankton from the water column and release filtered water. So they play a very important role. They act as indicators of overall ecosystem health and water quality, but they also play an important role in nutrient cycling as a prey source for some species. And so they're very ecologically significant. And so what are our study sites for this project? We looked at two lakes located in Cape Breton, Nova Scotia, Blackett's Lake and Pottle Lake. So Pottle Lake, chain pickerel are actually absent from Pottle Lake. It does serve as a municipal potable water source. And so access to this lake is restricted. And so luckily it's much more difficult for an invasive species to be introduced to this lake system. And we sampled it in 2021. And then Blackett's Lake chain pickerel were found in this lake in 2010. And it was sampled in 2013, 2018, and 2021. And so what's important is both lakes host both white perch and yellow lamp mussel. So it offers the opportunity for a comparison. So on the top, we have a picture of Pottle Lake and on the bottom, Blackett's Lake. And so this is just showing the four lakes in Nova Scotia where yellow lamp mussel are present. But of course, we're just focusing on Pottle Lake and Blackett's Lake. And they are in adjacent watersheds and therefore should have very similar species assemblage for comparison. So the methods, most importantly, we wanted to collect a very comprehensive and representative food web sample. So we targeted both habitat in the littoral, so near shore, and pelagic, so open water zones. We collected zooplankton, benthic macroinvertebrates, two species of mussel, a limited quantity of our yellow lamp mussel, and we collected eastern elliptio mussel, which is a more common mussel species. And then fish, of course, both native and introduced. So for the lab, of course, we collect our biometric data from all of our samples, but more importantly, we collected and dried and ground mussel tissue samples. So from dorsal mussel in fish and from the foot mussel in a yellow lamp mussel. And we sent these to the Stable Isotopes in Nature Laboratory in Fredericton, New Brunswick. And so what is stable isotope analysis? Stable isotope analysis definitely has a very, very wide variety of applications. However, it's really come forward as a forefront method for examining the structure and dynamics in aquatic food webs. So stable isotopes are forms of elements that do not decay into other elements over time. So they act as very consistent and reliable indicators that you can trace through different components of an ecosystem. So stable isotopes, they serve as ecological tracers. They allow us to map out the interactions within a food web by providing insights into both what an organism eats and how energy flows from one trophic level to another. So for this study, we're using carbon-13, also referred to as delta carbon 13, which is the ratio of carbon 13 to carbon 12, as well as nitrogen 15, referred to as delta nitrogen 15, and it's the ratio of nitrogen 15 to nitrogen 14. So nitrogen acts as an indication of an organism's trophic level position. And this is because as we move up each trophic level in the food web, delta nitrogen 15 increases at a rate of approximately 3.4 parts per mil per trophic level. So this is called stepwise enrichment, and it's really fundamental to understanding food web dynamics. So basically, as a predator consumes its prey, the heavier isotopes of nitrogen, so nitrogen 15, it becomes more concentrated in the predator's tissue. And so it's measuring this incremental increase in nitrogen 15 that we use to determine an organism's position within the food web hierarchy. And then delta carbon 13, it's used to track dietary sources of carbon from the base of the food web. And so the degree of enrichment or depletion can tell you whether that dietary source of carbon is pelagic or littoral in nature. So carbon 13 and nitrogen 15 are commonly plotted together to form a biplot. So again, interpreting this biplot can tell us a lot about trophic niche, and we can make inferences about predator-prey relationships and feeding habits. And so again, to interpret the axes, delta nitrogen 15 often correlates with an organism's trophic level position, more enriched in delta nitrogen 15 is occupying a higher trophic position. And then for our dietary sources of carbon, those are found on the x-axis, more depleted in carbon 13, usually derived from pelagic sources, and more enriched from littoral sources or near shore. And so again, analyzing this biplot can tell us a lot, one, about trophic position, two, about dietary sources of carbon, but again, the proximity of isotopic values of an organism of a potential predator to a potential prey source suggests likely feeding habits. And again, trophic niche can be inferred often from a stable isotope biplot. And so just to introduce trophic niche, it refers to the role a species plays in its ecosystem, specifically how it fits within the food web and its dietary habits. And this is just to represent that stepwise enrichment. And so I'm not going to talk about everything located on these biplots, but now that we've introduced a stable isotope biplot, you'll be more familiar. And so this is looking at Blackett's Lake, a time series from 2013, 2018, and lastly, 2021. And so we're going to focus on our species of interest, white perch with a blue triangle. The smaller size class of chain pickerel is a red circle, and the larger size class of chain pickerel, so again, over 15 centimeters, is this green circle that's not filled in. And so just quickly pointing out some of the most interesting relationship is white perch and chain pickerel appear to be occupying the same trophic level position, which is really important to note. So this is approximately 3 years after their introduction into the lake. In 2018, we're starting to see that chain pickerel occupy a more dominant top trophic position. Only two white perch were found at all in 2018 during the study. And then we see that the smaller size class of chain pickerel is more integrated throughout the food web. So we're kind of seeing this full establishment of that introduced species throughout the entirety of the food web.
And lastly,
okay, perfect, thank you. Lastly, in 2021, we were able to catch white perch and chain pickerel. Again, chain pickerel occupying that top trophic position, fully integrated throughout the food web. But now we're seeing white perch and those values concentrated in the pelagic zone, which I'll break down further. So then again, comparing our Blackett's Lake data from a lake, of course, with chain pickerel to our Pottle Lake data collected the same year in a lake without chain pickerel. I'll point out two things very quickly. White perch appear to occupy a trophic niche that is more thin, which I'll talk about in the next slide. But they're deriving these dietary sources of carbon almost solely from the pelagic zone, whereas in a lake without chain pickerel, they appear to have more variety in where they're deriving their sources of carbon. And secondly, we're seeing an elongated food web in a lake with chain pickerel, which is commonly seen because chain pickerel or any invasive top trophic predator can often carve out a new position in a food web that did not previously exist. So they elongate that food chain. And I don't have much time, but I'll really quickly talk about looking at trophic niche. So this ellipses is representing visually the trophic niche of each species. So in our first biplot, we see almost that they're completely overlapping, the trophic niche of our larger chain pickerel and white perch, which suggests a very high degree of competition. And in our second biplot, just looking from white perch in Blackett's Lake to white perch in Pottle Lake, what you're seeing is the breadth of carbon sources is kind of dramatically different, and it represents the range of carbon sources in a white perch's diet. So it's an indicator of dietary diversity. And so you're seeing that this is significantly reduced in Blackett's Lake. So what that means very quickly is it could mean changes in behavior and dietary habits to avoid this high degree of competition with chain pickerel. And in turn, any changes in behavior and diet can impact the potential for white perch and yellow lamp mussel to coincide in certain habitats in the lake, potentially leading to declines in yellow lamp mussel recruitment. So this project is ongoing. We're ongoing quantitative data analysis and writing. But overall, I just wanted to touch on the piscivorous nature of chain pickerel and how this paired lake experimental design allowed us to assess their impacts in a lake with and without. Thank you.
Thank you, Erin. So we do have quite a few minutes left for questions. So we don't have too many right now. So if you did have a question for Erin, please put it in the Q&A chat. One question we do have is, can chain pickerel hybridize with native species?
That hasn't been seen in any of our lake systems here in Nova Scotia. And they're often the only species in the pike family in Nova Scotia, New Brunswick.
All right, thank you. So we'll just give it another few minutes for questions to come in. Okay, so one question we have is, this is an amazing way to quantify food web dynamics. Do you know if this has been done for other aquatic invasions?
Yeah, definitely. I'm starting to see it more and more often, and there's definitely kind of giant leaps in stable isotope analysis as time goes on and it becomes far more popular. But I've definitely seen it even just locally used more for invasions of smallmouth bass, and of course, chain pickerel in Nova Scotia. And I know there's quite a few students doing similar studies within our lab with chain pickerel in Nova Scotia.
Thank you. Okay, I think we have time for one more question. So this one is, if the population of white perch populations are increasing, can the invasive species in this perch find a balance, even if it means white perch are no longer the top predator?
Yeah, there's definitely potential for that to happen. And it was very surprising to people that we did catch so many white perch in that 2021 data set. Especially where in 2018, they put a lot of effort into catching white perch and only caught two. And so you can see some species find a balance with chain pickerel over time. And of course, yeah, that might lead either way to lower recruitment in yellow lamp mussel, which it has since 2018. They've seen significant declines, but it is possible.
Thank you. So we actually do have time for one more question. Really interesting talk. What are the sizes of the pickerel? Maybe they also change the size structure of their preys. So I guess the question is, what are the sizes of the pickerel, the chain pickerel?
Again, we had quite a few from the smaller size class in certain years, which is under 15 centimeters. But some of our biggest, I think our biggest chain pickerel was around 52 centimeters. And they usually ranged in that larger size class around the 30 centimeter mark. And then our white perch were significantly larger in 2021 than what we usually see, or in the larger kind of size class for white perch. And so what we might see is that larger fish are able to potentially compete with the chain pickerel, whereas smaller fish of other species have trouble doing this. And that's why sometimes you see that like truncation in fish size distribution that I talked about earlier.
Great. Thank you very much, Erin. That's all we have for questions right now. Next up, we have a presentation from Brooke Schreier from the Federation of Anglers and Hunters. So whenever you're ready, Brooke.
All right. Well, you can see that okay. All right, thanks, Jen. And thank you to the Invasive Species Center, and again, for accepting yet another one of my abstracts to come and present. And today I will be presenting on the first wild record of marbled crayfish, so Procambarus virginalis in North America. And we'll jump it right off. So for this presentation, I do have quite a few slides, so I apologize if I speak quickly. Hopefully, I will have enough time to get through all of my slides. First, I'm going to go over what is the marbled crayfish or marmor crabs, and why is that significant for us here in Ontario and Canada and North America. And then we're going to go through the history of the first detection, as well as some of the follow-up monitoring and eradication efforts to date that have been undertaken by us, as well as many of our amazing partners. And then talking about some of the next steps for our working group. So first, just to kick things off, so you guys kind of understand who I am and where I'm coming from. So I'm Brooke Schreier, I'm the Assistant Coordinator with the Invasive Species Awareness Program. And the ISAP was created in 1992 as an education and awareness partnership between the Ontario Federation of Anglers and Hunters, my host organization, and the Ministry of Natural Resources and Forestry. And if you're not familiar, the OFAH is Ontario's largest not-for-profit fish and wildlife conservation organization with 100,000 members, subscribers, and supporters, including 725 membership clubs. And back in 1992, they saw that invasive species were, you know, causing some major issues in the province, particularly with the invasion of the zebra mussel, which we heard about earlier, and decided to partner with the province to create what is now the Invading Species Awareness Program. As a program, our core mandates are to, as I said, generate education awareness, but we also facilitate monitoring and early detection through various means, the Invading Species Hotline or EDMAPS, the Early Detection and Distribution Mapping System. And then we also support surveillance, control, and response, as in the case with the marbled crayfish that I'm here to talk about today. So with that brief introduction, what is marbled crayfish, marmor crabs, and why is it significant for us? So sorry, this slide is so word heavy, but really just wanted to get all the quick facts out there for you guys so you understand. If you've never heard of marbled crayfish, it is a crayfish that reproduces parthenogenically. And so there's only females that are known to exist within the population, and can confirm from our surveillance of the crayfishes that we have found, spoiler alert, that they are, no gonopods were found in any of those crayfishes, so that they're all female. And where it originated was actually, it's kind of a freaky story. So it's in Germany back in 1995, it was suspected to have been created when sloth crayfish, which are native to the US, were imported to Germany, and then, you know, marbled crayfish came as a result. And then, interestingly enough, you know, marbled crayfish were then shipped kind of worldwide for the aquarium trade. So it's kind of interesting when you look at it, how it's, you know, native to the States, brought over to Germany to then, you know, have this hybridization or this occurrence occur where you create a marbled crayfish, and then to have it shipped all over the place. So it's really interesting, speaks to globalization. And in terms of its climactic tolerances, it can survive in a wide temperature range, and can, you know, survive through temporary exposures below 8 degrees Celsius. And the literature suggests that what you need and what you're going to see in this presentation and what we're trying to achieve is that it needs to be revealed to 1 to 2 degrees Celsius for more than 2 weeks. So what we've been trying to do, which I'll get into a little bit later, is freeze them out. And I'll tell you whether or not that's been successful in a bit. In terms of habitat, you know, a wide range of habitats from ponds, lakes, canals, ditches, rivers, streams, you name it, you know, this girl will live in it. It also constructs burrows, but they're very cryptic. I don't think we've actually seen one yet, but just like many of, you know, many crayfishes, they will create those burrows to escape the cold. And theirs are particularly unique without chimneys, similar to the White River crayfish that Premick presented on. In terms of vectors of introduction, I've already spoken to this, but you know, aquarium trade, both as a pet, but then also as fish food, because of the way that she reproduces, it's quite easy to have a stock of these crayfish, which you can then use as food for your predator fish, for example. We've also heard stories from abroad of contaminated fish shipments. One particular case was goldfish, where marble crayfish was suspected to have been introduced via a shipment of goldfish. And then if and when there's a circumstance where these are in our ecosystems, which is not the case yet, that there would be a potential for bait release via anglers wanting to use crayfish as bait. So what are the impacts? I think we can all, you know, here, I'm sure we all have some experience with invasive species, so we understand the general impacts, and it's no different here. You know, they would compete with native crayfishes and fish, they would alter our food webs, they would negatively impact biodiversity. And because of their reproductive strategies, they kind of represent a very high risk for establishment once introduced, as you can imagine. You know, with many species, when a risk assessment is done to determine its ability to establish, they usually have to take into account, you know, male, female, number of specimens, environment, et cetera, food availability, you name it, predation. But in this case, all you need is one. All you need is a single female who is, you know, who can survive a round of reproduction to then give birth to offspring. So beyond that, there's also other factors in terms of predation on invertebrates. We've been talking about our native clams and those types of things for the presentations. There's also the herbivory, which is common across all crayfishes. And then, you know, in terms of where they have been established worldwide, one of those places is Madagascar. And there is literature from Madagascar suggesting that these things have had quite detrimental impacts on their fisheries. So we could expect the same here in Ontario and North America. So let's jump into the history of the first detection. And this is really the meat and potatoes of the presentation. So back in October of 2021, there was the first record to iNaturalist. Now, unfortunately, that was recorded as a Cambarid crayfish. So it was in the family Cambaridae. And, you know, that kind of eluded us for a little while. As you can imagine, there are thousands of reports that are put on iNaturalist with varying degrees of certainty in terms of their identification. And it wasn't until a few months later that it was brought to our attention. And once it was, the MNRF attempted to make contact with the reporter. Then Dr. Hammer, he sent photos to his colleagues in Czech Republic who had experience with marble crayfish, and they were able to possibly identify it as marbles. And then given the time of year, it was so late in the year, we decided to delay until the spring of 2022 to do any form of surveillance or monitoring at the location. So when we first got there in 2022, Prema came with me alongside one of my other coworkers, and we initially went to survey the location of the iNaturalist report. So you can see on the map there, kind of towards the north, and we did not find any burrows. We did not find any crayfishes. And then we made contact with the groundskeeper, and the groundskeeper had asked us what we were doing there. And we told him we were looking for crayfishes, to which he provided us with this photograph from the year prior. So from 2021, he found this guy crawling across one of the soccer pitches. So just going back here, as you can see on the map, that's where he found the crayfish crawling. So quite a distance away from the ponds. These things are known to travel across land. And when we saw the photos, Premick was in the van and he looked up and he said, yep, that looks like a marble crayfish to me. So we quickly started enacting various surveillance techniques, including eDNA sampling. Chris Wilson, who you'll be hearing from here in the next little while, his lab is amazing and they're always the ones processing our eDNA. And we were also doing kick and sweeps just in the occurrence that maybe we catch one. And then we also planted passive baits with all sorts of different bait varieties, like, you know, cat food and those types of things. So that day, here's some images from that day. As I said, we did the eDNA, we did kick and sweeps. We just looked for any signs of crayfish whatsoever, and we did not find any. We did find that there was quite the abundance of non-native fish species, as one would expect with these types of ponds in a fairly urbanized area. So we found goldfish and rosy cheek minnows, those types of things, nothing native. And we also did not find any crayfish. So then moving on to August 2022, we said, well, you know, we didn't get really any good eDNA, or we didn't get any eDNA from the first round. So let's go back, let's look again. So this time we decided, you know what, we weren't seeing any signs of crayfish. So let's just focus on eDNA. And we did 24 samples. We did 6 samples per pond. And this will kind of show you those general locations. The pond, well, it's not really a pond, but that's what looks like a pond on the south side of the connection, is completely dried out, but there was some drainage there. So there was a culvert. So we decided to collect some water there and send it for analysis. And unfortunately it did come back with some positives for marble crayfish. So again, we wanted to make sure that we were getting, you know, proper samples. We wanted to confirm what we had found already. So we went back again in October of 2022 to collect more eDNA samples. Again, we did 24 samples. There are some of my colleagues there. So Jillian's on the left, who was an intern with OFAH, and then Rob McGowan, who is our program specialist with ISAP, doing some eDNA. And unfortunately, those also came back positive. And once they were positive, we still didn't have a crayfish in hand, but at this point we formed what is the Marble Crayfish Working Group, with representation from the province, the federal, federal entities, the city of Burlington, which have been fantastic in helping us, as well as Conservation Halton. So then in the winter of 2022, as a working group, what we did was we worked with the city of Burlington to dewater the ponds. As I said, the literature has said that there's high mortality for marble crayfish when they're exposed to more than 2 weeks of 1 to 2 degrees Celsius. So we've all been, you know, all of us in the working group have been crossing our fingers, hoping for a cold winter. And 2022, 2023 winter was not really that. It was cold. There were cold, periods, but not cold enough. And we also weren't able to get the ponds quite as low as I think we wanted to last year. But we did, you know, install some fine wire mesh, which was earlier in the fall, and then we did the dewatering in the winter. And there are some images. So you saw that those images before from where we were doing those kick and sweeps on early on in our surveillance. And this is that same location, same spot where we had done those kick and sweeps. Then jumping into May, June, 2023. So we decided, given our proximity to the park, we're quite a ways away. We're 2 hours one way, so about 4 hour round trip. Conservation Halton offered to take over the eDNA. So we decided, sure, you know, we went down, we handed off the kits, and they started doing some eDNA sampling, and they did get some weak results. But then on July 5th, 2023, a text message was received to me from the groundskeeper, and a crayfish had been found on the pavilion, of which we were able to confirm it was a marbled crayfish, as you see there in the photo.
3 minutes left, bro.
That kind of opened the floodgates, and we started seeing a lot more specimens. So July 12th, a week later, we had the second specimen. Then July 13th, Conservation Halton captured specimens. Then, you know, as you can imagine, just more and more started to be captured. We went back. There's my colleague there, Jeff Berthelet. He's one of our outreach liaisons getting in there. You also saw him in Premix presentation catching some crayfish. So he's our crayfish catcher. So we were able to, that day, with Jeff's net skills, capture a juvenile marble crayfish. So that was the first time we were actually able to catch one in the pond, which was really interesting. And then we went back in October, and I'm going to try to speed up here, I apologize. We went back in October of last year, and we decided to expand our search. You can see some eDNA results from, you know, the first location. These were done by Conservation Halton, and this was the first location where that INAT report had come up. Here are the ponds, and then here is a pond which we call Novak Pond, which is connected underground to the ponds. And so presumably while we're getting positive eDNA, I'm happy to report that we've searched these areas as a working group in October. We did not find any crayfish in Novak Pond, nor did we find any crayfish up here. We're still only finding crayfish in the ponds where they've been detected. And there's just an aerial of the Novak Pond. So then, as I said, we expanded our search to other areas. You have Chris Wilson in the back there using his backpack sampler for eDNA. You have folks from DFO. They were amazing. They came out with us over the 2 days to look. And then these are the different methods that we use for eDNA. We did the syringe method. And then, as I said, Chris Wilson did the backpack method. And then we also use passive samplers. There's Jeff again. And then the day two, we went out, we again expanded our search even further. We were looking all over the place around the area, just hoping that this isn't a more widespread issue. And what we found that day was northern clearwaters, a native species, and a very grumpy looking Camberus robustus, or big water crayfish, who looked like he just wanted to be put back in the water. And then in the afternoon of day two, we went back to City View Park. And as you can imagine, we captured many more marbled crayfish, and you see all their carapace lengths there on the right. Then you see Dr. Hammer catching his first one with Trisha from DFO, again, who was out helping us. That was Premix's first capture of a marbled crayfish. And then as you can see, some of the captures we had that day, including some goldfish. And then some more juveniles, young of year, you know, 6 millimeter carapace length, 3 millimeter carapace length. So we have a reproducing population here. Now, most importantly, jumping into this year, with my last few minutes here, MNRF has been working with the city of Burlington to drain the ponds even further, even more drawn down than year one. And so Jake, who is with MNRF, went out in December and was able to handpick 54 marbled crayfish. This is what they were doing, just laying there on the substrate. Didn't find any signs of burrows, but it was really hard to see because there's so much frag there. And as I said, was able to capture, or well, not really capture, but pick up 54 marbled crayfish. And then, so this is the dewatering that's going on this year. And as you can see, you know, we're hoping for some cold temperatures. We have not got it, but we're doing another dewatering this month because we're supposed to get a cold spell here. And it's actually snowing as I speak. So hopefully it'll get cold enough for long enough to kill off the rest of these nasty females. Because as I said on the left there, you see that the literature has suggested that they'll die if they're revealed to more than 2 weeks of 1 to 2 degrees. So in closing, last few slides, here is the size classes that we've seen to date. So these are all the captures. We've had 89 total captures, everything from Conservation Halton to us to, you know, Jake going in and capturing 54. So these are all of them. As you can see, there's quite the diversity in sizes, meaning that they are going through reproductive cycles and even potentially two in a calendar year. And here's what we're doing, next steps, more education outreach, more resources. We're expanding our search. So we're making sure that this isn't a bigger problem. We're making sure that this is, you know, kept in those ponds so that we can continue towards eradicating this nasty species so that, you know, it does not become a bigger issue. Here's some of the signage that we've installed. Here's some of the signage that City of Burlington has installed. And then finally, thank you so much for, you know, affording me the time to speak about this today. We're going to continue working as a working group. It's so great to see all the representation from the various, you know, governments, Government of Ontario, you know, the Canadian government, as well as so many of us ENGOs working towards eradication, because we were able to catch this species early. And as we all know, rapid response is key to eradication. So if you'd like to get in touch with me, I know somebody asked about signs earlier. There's my email there, brooke_schreier@ofh.org. Please shoot me an email requesting signage. You can also give us a call on the Being Species hotline, 1-800-563-7711. And at this point, I'd be more than happy to take any questions that you may have. If I have time, that is.
Yeah, we have a couple minutes. Thank you, Brooke. We do have quite a few good questions in the Q&A box here. So the first one is there any evidence of marbled crayfish being traded by crayfish enthusiasts in Ontario? They've been traded and sold, attempted, intercepted. Sorry. In the US, my understanding is that they are being raised by enthusiasts in their basements, very much under our radar screen. Yeah. On how to intercept this pathway.
Yeah, absolutely. We have been seeing that, and we've all been kind of working collectively towards getting that information to the powers that, you know, need to know that. So to the MNRF, to the TIPS hotline. Anytime we've seen them for sale on Kijiji, people are coming up with new and inventive ways of selling these things without actually naming them. So self-cloning crayfish or blue crayfish or, you know, whatever they can say. However, I've even seen ads that have said prohibited crayfish for sale. So, you know, I think the knowledge amongst the community is divided. I think some people know and are doing it regardless. And I think there are some people who just genuinely don't know. And, you know, I think it's our responsibility to ensure that they are getting that information to know that marbled crayfish are prohibited, you know, in the province of Ontario, as well as their genus is also prohibited. So yes, the answer is yes, we've seen it. And yes, I can't speak to the enforcement too much, but I am aware that enforcement has been occurring to try to stop these sales.
Yeah, I can just add that the inspectors, the MNRF inspectors, have been tracking the online sales and are talking to those people. I don't think we've had any convictions, but I know that they're tracking it, and they're looking at Kijiji and so on, tracking the sales and trying to talk to the people and get them to do the right thing.
Great, perfect. I think we have time for one more. So the next question is, I'm curious if there's correlation between the habitat that Phragmites cause and the success of these invasive crayfish.
I'll let Premek answer that one. But real quick, I would say, I mean, they do like things to hide in, right?
I would say there's correlation with vegetation. They like vegetation. That's what the Europeans tell me. They always say, look in the vegetation. But there's very little ecological studies. They're just starting, especially in the field. So, you know, there's one in Croatia, one in Poland, where they've invaded, but there's very little ecological stuff. So we're just at the tip of it. Not enough research.
So I think that's all the time we have. Thank you again, Brooke. And then wrapping up our session this morning are Samantha Smith and Katie O'Shaughnessy from the Dauphin Island Sea Lab. So whenever you both are ready.